Well, hey there, fellow Viking. It is I, your comrade, Ulrik Olafsson.
Hey, it's Gart Wolfslinger here.
Have you gathered all your warriors?
I've got them all here.
It's raiding season.
It's raiding time.
It's time to impress the chieftain by gaining the most victory points.
Man, he's tough.
Now, the only thing he likes is offerings, victory points, and plunder, which is vital to our success as Viking raiders.
Today on The Board Boys,
Raiders of the North Sea.
Everybody, welcome to another episode of the Board Boys podcast, season 5, episode
5.
We're playing Raiders of the North Sea tonight. This is your host, the 13th Warrior Viking, Board Boy Josh.
This is your host, Las Vegas Raiders Rob.
This is your host, Skyrim is for the Nords, Campbell D'Souza.
Hey, I wasn't kidding, it's Gart Wolfslinger.
We have a special guest tonight, Gart Wolfslinger.
Hey, Gart. I saw you pull up in your longboat earlier.
Yeah, how you doing, Gart?
I paid 3 pelts for that.
Okay. I want Ben to keep this going all episode.
Are you
going to
be Gart the whole time? Are you going to be Gart your whole life?
I've been Gart since the gods were young.
This is good.
We're playing Raiders of the North Sea tonight from Renegade Game Studios and Garphill Games. And we'll talk
That's
about
Garphill Games.
We'll talk about that in just a second here, but before we do, let's take it around the table to find out what folks have been playing lately. Ben, you've been gone for a while. You got any games played?
I played several games of Architects of the West Kingdom, similar to this game, same designers. Also taught a couple friends Azul. So, fun, obviously, go-to short game, easy to teach people. And I love it when they look confused at first.
And then they just get it. It clicks and they just get it.
They just get it.
Anything else from you, my man?
Just playing with your heart.
I've played a ton of games since we got together.
One metric ton.
For our last recording. But I'm not going to talk about most of them because Board Boy Rob and I are going to do a special one-off recap episode of our time at BGGCon a couple weeks ago and the games that we played while we were in Dallas, Texas. But I have played a couple other new games to me since we got back from BGGCon. I played a game called... Brussels 1893 or something like that.
Is that the card game version?
No, we played the... we did not... There were cards involved, but
heard
we did not play...
That game's really sprouting up the top 100.
We did not play the card game version. That game was crazy. The artwork was so... it's the same guy that did the artwork for Twa, and so it's just kind of straightforward, but the mechanisms are so weird. Like at the beginning, so there's a, if you can imagine, and it's, I don't know the exact dimensions, but we'll say there's a player board area that's a 5x5 grid.
It's 14 feet by 3 inches.
It's a 5x5 grid, and then within that, there are a bunch of different repeating spaces. So there's like a build and a buy art and a sell art, and they just repeat in different colors. And then in the middle of all of the intersection points, there are these little shields. So every round, you flip a stock market card, and it tells you what size square you're going to be playing in for the round. And the player that's going first gets to decide between two coordinates. So you can decide if you want it to go on the 3-4 or on the 4-3 and have access to those things to do over the course of the round. Then when you play your workers, you bid a dollar amount because there are actions at the bottom of each of the rows in addition to the action that you're taking that you're trying to potentially win by bidding the most monies over the course of that round.
a minion.
There's a whole secondary board where you can go and take a couple different actions, but the more that you go there, you have to pay more resources. So you're often just dropping your guys on this primary action board, as we'll call it. But then at the end of the round, you see who's bid the most money, and they get the card at the bottom. And then where the game gets really interesting is there's an immediate benefit right at the top, and then the player can decide to either keep the card or like tuck it on the side of their board to increase one of the actions to make it worth more points at the end of the game when it's scoring. It is 1000% not a game that I would normally pick to play. But the reason I like my dad's game group is because we have a bunch of different tastes in the group, and my friend Ryan brought it and we played that and it was nuts. Like, I know Secret Cabal has really good things to say about it. I could definitely see why, but as I was playing it, I was like, this is a game that Rob and Campbell, if they have not played it before, they would absolutely adore this game. It's super dry.
So it's a couple years ago,
right? The mechanisms
are
so cool. Yeah.
Because they just released like a card version of it, and it's confusing because they're both the same name. They just have different years. So that's why I was asking.
Yeah, no, I did not play the card version. But yeah, I think you guys would really, really dig that one.
Rob, I think I've cracked what Euros Josh likes.
I wouldn't even say I liked it. I just thought the mechanisms were really cool.
Is it just
like,
one?
There were so many things to have to keep track of that I was like, oh, that's... But so like when you sell art, there's only two types of art that you can sell. But then there's a little square that, depending on how much art you have in your collection, you can move the square a certain number of spaces to dictate how much fame and gold you get when you sell the painting. Like there was just so many little neat things to have to think about. I don't think it was necessarily a game for me, but then as I was playing it, I was like, oh, that's really clever. Oh, that's really clever. Oh, that's really clever. I really like the way this all comes together. But again, I would probably never pick to play it myself again.
Okay, so you didn't like it. You thought it was cool.
I thought it was cool. And I think, I mean, objectively, I thought it was a cool game. Subjectively, it's not a game that I would ever choose to play, which I think is okay. It's like
that just does not compute in my brain.
It's like TI4. Like people can look at TI4 and be like, that's a really good game, but it's not a game that I will ever play. It's kind of like that, you know?
Sure.
Like
you can recognize
when a game is a good game, it's just not a game that you would want
to play. And he can respect a game for what it is.
Right. So
while knowing he'd hate it.
No, I get that. So you didn't like it then, but you realize it is a good game.
That is a better way of saying it.
Because
yeah.
If you liked something, then you should want to play it again.
He didn't hate that he had played it. He didn't. He wasn't ready to play again.
That I enjoyed, but I didn't want to go on another date with the person.
What did Campbell say? It's a great way to waste 45 minutes. Or
no, I
yeah.
Said,
let's put that on the side of the box.
That's not at all what I said. I said that the game was a
enjoyable
good,
distraction,
enjoyable
for
diversion
45 minutes.
For 45 minutes to an hour. Yeah.
How long was the game?
The Bruxelles 18 hour and a half maybe. We played with three players. But yeah, so that one was really fun.
It was a scrumptious 90 minute trifle.
Yeah, I will say just real quick, I also played Meeple Circus with the expansion that I picked up at BGGCon, and that it adds some really, really fun new meeples.
It does.
I don't know if you've played it, Rob, or you have it. Mm-hmm. My favorite is there's an acrobat that has like a little, it's like a ramp, a jump, whatever, but you put him on the edge. And then at the end of the round, you flick it and the meeple flies up in the air and you have to catch the meeple and then place it on top of something in your circus act without having it fall over in order for him to score points.
Yep, that's really fun.
And it's awesome because like you see somebody like whack it and it goes flying up because they want to make sure they catch it. And then they catch it, but then they have to place it and it's really fun.
Does the expansion have the tomatoes in it too? Or is that a different promo I have?
I think that's a different promo.
Because I've got a promo that's really fun too, where if you draw this tile while you're performing, like people get to throw tomatoes at you.
Oh, it's like one of the blue ones?
Yeah, like these cardboard tokens.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. No, I haven't played with that one. That sounds really fun though. Yeah, so I played Meeple Circus with the expansion. I played Tiny Epic Quest, and then I put up like my best score ever in the original Clank. And I introduced a friend to Patchwork. So those are all of the games that I've played besides BGGCon stuff since we had our last episode. Rob, Campbell, what about you guys?
I could go, or Rob, you can go. What do you think? There's only one game I played that I didn't play with Rob that was new to me. So first and foremost,
I played a game called Soul of the Empire from 2018 by a small company whose name I can't remember. But this is a neat little game that I think released to like pretty good reviews, but it's not crazy popular. It's a game about trying to, I don't know, do the best conquering of Rome, except it takes place around like 50 AD, and there's four factions. The game would be a game that I would recommend to people who love Root, and also have an interest in like early Western Civ, because you play as the Romans, or a coalition of like Germanic and Druidic tribe type people, or you can play as the Israelites or Jews, or you can play as the Christians, and each faction can win by earning a number of points in specific ways. However, each of them have their own goal and way they play. And the Romans are kind of like, for those of you who played Root, the Romans are kind of like the cats, where they get tons and tons of troops and just millions of resources, and it's hard to like snuff them out. Then the Germanic tribes are kind of like barbarians, where they have a rage counter that makes battles like better for them when they've lost a few times in a row. The Israelites have all sorts of like ways to like do specific things within kind of their territory, like the states around Israel. And the Christians, instead of fighting outright, generally are trying to convert the other troops into their own. It is a pretty interesting game that I think could be one of those that one of the factions might seem way easier when you play it for the first time, but as you get to understand the game, it could be a really good game for a group that plays it often. So I would recommend checking it out if you like that era of history and games with asymmetrical factions, because it was fun. I will say I converted the necessary amount of people to my cause to win the game. So, Hosanna! I did it.
Nice. Rob, what about you?
I played probably the most games in the past 3 weeks that I've ever played in my life. Went to BGGCon, and then got back from BGGCon, and it was Thanksgiving week. And my brother-in-law and his wife came and stayed with us for the whole week. And before they moved to San Diego, they'd come over a couple times a week and we'd play games. And so when they came, they were coming, they essentially said, plan on not sleeping, we're going to game a lot.
Nice.
And we did.
Just went 6 to midnight, you know?
Yeah.
I don't even know what to talk about. Let's talk about a couple of newer things. I played the new Clank expansion, the Temple of the Ape Lords. And I played only one of the side of the boards. Two of the three of us didn't even get out. That was cool. And so we didn't get a score. But it had a really cool mechanism where, like, you could play these gear token things that would rotate these gears, which would change the paths as you're running around the dungeon. I think it was mainly because just the way the cards were coming out and the gorilla was attacking us so frequently, but we were just getting pounded on and pounded on hard. I hadn't played Clank for a long time. I played Clank in Space, which I feel like it's a lot easier to heal and like stay alive in Clank in Space. We were struggling to stay alive in the original Clank, and it was kind of fun to go back. Like, I feel like the original Clank is like more difficult than Clank in Space as far as like scoring and being able to get in and out. I'm not sure why exactly. I can't put my finger on why it is, but I just feel that way. I'm going to be excited to see, we're going to be starting a Clank Legacy campaign soon and just see how that differs from the original Clank. We busted out the new Mansions of Madness expansion, the Temple of the Serpent, I believe it's called. And we played two of the three of the new scenarios, and they are pretty sweet. The two we played are like in that nice 60 to 90 minute sweet spot, and the one we didn't play was a little longer. But there's plenty of puzzles. The new mechanisms, like the jungle can pop up, and there can be like weeds in your way and rubble, and so you have to clear rubble, and you have to be able to like chop through weeds. That's kind of the new stuff, and you know, it just added more cards, more characters. The new miniatures are good. It's just an all around great new expansion for Mansions of Madness, second edition. And then we dusted off one that the last time I played it was in 2015, I think. And we started the campaign in 2013. And that game is Risk Legacy. We are now two games away from finishing this. Originally, my son was born, and that's kind of what knocked us off track. And then one of our players moved, and then our other player moved. And then I don't really see the other guy that's playing much anymore. So when my brother-in-law came back, he was one of the ones that moved away. And I'm like, hey, let's see if we can knock this out. So we brought Campbell over. He filled in, and we played a three-player game. And we've all but one thing unlocked. The only thing we don't have unlocked in our campaign, if you're familiar with it, is they have put 30 troops on the board and have a nuke in your hand. We still haven't unlocked that yet. And we also haven't unlocked the... spoiler alert, there's an envelope underneath the insert. If you don't know that by now, I don't even know if they sell Risk Legacy anymore. But anyway, we haven't opened that yet either. I'm going to open that up for our last game. But I think now that we've got the streaming set up, I might try to just Skype him in and try to finish the game remotely. We did that when we were finishing up Seafall, and that actually worked pretty well. I'd like to just get this game off my shelf.
Hey, can I say something really quick as a guy who played one game of it?
Yes, sir.
I was super impressed. It was so cool.
Yeah, I highly recommend, like, if you enjoyed Risk at all as a child, Risk Legacy is going to blow you away. It has all the trappings of Risk, and it just adds in more game. It's by Rob Davio, who's done a lot of Legacy games. And there's a really funny story about him, like, trying to get that through at Hasbro. Like, I'm sure if you go out there on the internet, you can find it. But essentially, like, I think he was kind of on his way out. And they were kind of letting him do kind of anything he wanted. And he kind of just kind of got this pushed through. Like, this is something, like, not in a million years, like, Hasbro would ever do. But somehow they stumbled through it and got it put out there. And it was a pretty popular one for him.
It was so cool.
That was a really bad telling in that story. But it is pretty interesting if you can find that online somewhere. And then I've got a ton of stuff that I'm going to say for our BGG recap episode. But right now, let's go and check out Architects of the West Kingdom, Raiders of the North Sea.
Raiders of the North Sea came out in 2015. It's currently got a score of 7.8 out of 10. Rob, where does the score of 7.8 out of 10 put Raiders of the North Sea?
83.
Okay, Campbell, we can just stop playing because it's 83.
Directly behind Architects of the West Kingdom.
Yeah, it's 83.
Is it directly behind Architects?
No. Probably not. I mean, are they? They're different games.
They are different games.
Are they different games?
I think they're back to back on the common belief.
They look very similar because of the same art style.
Well, yeah, but that's like saying that, as we'll talk about later, that Architects of the West Kingdom is the same game as Paladins of the West Kingdom because the artwork is the same and it's both something of the West Kingdom.
It's true.
But they're completely different games. Anyway, 2 to 4 players, best with 3. Way to go, Ben. 60 to 80 minutes.
You're welcome.
Ages 12 plus.
Way to go, Josh, for being
Shem
over 12.
2.54 out of 5.
It is Shem...
Phillips.
Shem Phillips? Yes, Shem Phillips does all these games.
Okay,
I checked it out earlier. Yep. So, yeah, Architects.
I always thought it was better when it was Curly Phillips, but I like Shem too.
And Campbell is correct. It's Architects of the West Kingdom's 82. Raiders of the North Sea is 83. Rob, what are we going to be doing tonight?
Oh, man, this game's one game worse than Architects.
Yeah.
I don't want to play it again then.
Why?
Because Architects is objectively better from BGG.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but it's subjectively better than Architects to me. At least I remember it
That's
being
true.
That way.
So I played this game a couple times. We've already got it set up in front of us. Pretty easy setup. We essentially dump a bunch of resources on the board. There's two actions you can do. One of the actions is set your guys out to raid. The other one is to work. So you can work in your own little village that you got going here at the bottom of the board. Or you can raid farther out along the board. As you go farther up, you get more points. The stuff you do at home kind of just... makes you better, like moves you up the armory track, which helps you fight, gives you resources, gets you money so you can buy cards, gets you more cards. But the real meat is when you start going out there and raiding. And raiding will take different kind of tokens, like you might need some supplies. And then from the supplies, you'll then get like cattle and gold and ore. The real kicker mechanic here, or mechanism, is you put a worker down, and then you're going to pick a guy up, and you get to do the action for both. So when you put a guy down, you take that action, and then you pick someone up, and you also get to do the action. At the end of the game can happen one of three ways. One of the ways is there's an offering pile of tiles here, which essentially are set collection. You can collect cows and gold and the ore and money and turn them in for these certain tiles. Once that deck is gone, the game can end, or the game can end if there's only one fortress. There's six fortresses on the far end of the board that are worth the most points. If all but one of the fortresses have been taken over, the game will end. Or if there's no more Valkyries left on the board, which are these little black tokens, which when you raid a place with a Valkyrie, the Valkyrie will actually kill one of your explorers that are going out there and fighting. But that also moves you up this Valkyrie track, which will score you points. At the end of the game, you're going to score points for some various tracks you've gone up. You're going to count up the points that you've acquired during the game through the set collection and the raiding. And may the best Viking win.
Do you think it's going to be Vart Wolfslinger?
It's Gart!
Gart.
With a G.
Gart
I think it's going to be Gart Slinger? Simpson.
The Gartsons.
Anyway, I have not played this one. I'm really excited about it. Ben, Campbell, anything you guys want to add? Gart, anything you want to add?
I was born for this.
I was born on the wagon of a traveling show.
We'll be back. Gart, we just got done playing Raiders of the North Sea, currently 84 on the BGG Top 100 list. Let's take it around the table for some immediate reactions. Gart, we're going to start with
Gart
you.
Gart goes second to no man.
What did you think, Gart?
This is a pretty fun game. If you like the art for Architects of the West Kingdom, it is the same artist whose name
ostensibly
is...
well, he goes by... Because he doesn't... It's not like a common first name, last name. Campbell, what'd you think?
I like Raiders of the North Sea better than I like Architects of the West Kingdom, and not as much as I like most worker placement games.
Spoilers.
Is this a guy's sword floppy instead of a floppy hat?
He's got a floppy sword. Yeah. Dude, that's a super floppy sword.
What'd you think?
This is my second time playing Raiders of the North Sea. I still enjoy it. I think that it's one that if I found cheap enough, I'd probably buy it. Because I think it's pretty simple to get to the table, and I really enjoy the mechanisms.
My immediate reaction, I have now played all three of the base games or whatever. I don't even know if they're base games. I played Raiders. I played Paladins. I played Architects. This is my least favorite of the three by a mile.
There's two more
that you
haven't played.
Did you still like it?
Yes. No, I did not. I did not enjoy
it. So
this.
You didn't like it?
I did not enjoy
it. Objectively or subjectively?
Both, which we'll talk about later. I think the game has a lot of cool things going for it. There's some mechanisms I thought were hip, which we can talk about here. But overall, this game, there was just a lot of things that
Big
I thought
hip
were wrong
guy
with
over
it.
Here.
Anyway, anyone want to start us off with pros?
Sure.
Go ahead.
Three big pros. One is the turns generally are really quick, the two action mechanism. When you're building to go raid is neat. You place a worker to take action one and you pick up a worker to take action two. That makes the other player's turns exciting because you're waiting for the right combination of the two things you want to do be there for you. So that's thing two. Thing three is the scoring is really straightforward, so it's easy to tell where you stand as you're getting
into
the end game.
There's no like hidden scoring.
Right.
Yep.
Those are three big pros for me.
Pros for me, and one of them, at least one, builds off of what Cam said. Two of them build off of what Cam said. I like creative twists on worker placement, so the setting down a worker and taking one out, I'm not saying it's the first time it's ever been done, but rather than just looking for one spot to play or hoping one spot's not taken, you can be pretty flexible with what you do.
I mean, I haven't played all of the games in the world, but this is the only one I can think of that does that. So I mean, it's pretty unique. Zolkin
and I have
a place a worker take. Oh, but you're not doing it in the same turn.
Yeah. Correct.
Okay. I've played all of the games in the world.
Oh, okay.
And I can't think of one an, other. I can't one think of like another this, game of where name. You play it and you take it immediately.
Oh man. Around the world. Well, there you have it. Officially.
So it's official. It's a creative take on worker placement.
Yes, I would agree with that.
So, and then, like Cam said, you're waiting for the right combinations of open spots.
Yeah.
But there's also three colors of workers, and those start to get scattered around. And when you raid, that worker stays there. So it's not just you want to get the higher level workers. It's you really don't know by the time in a four-player game, by the time it comes around to you again, what's going to be available. And right in the middle of the game, there's a pretty good mix, but it's still, you need the right combination of guys in the spot you need and colors of workers. So there was a couple times that I was ready to raid, but had to wait a turn because it didn't have the right color.
Yeah. Well, you weren't here for last time at Yokohama, but it's interesting we played these games back to back because there's a really interesting mix of tactics and strategy in this game that I talked about like last time, where a lot of the stuff you do is planning ahead for the next several turns, but what you're maybe doing on the next time it comes around to you is oftentimes largely conditional based on what the people right in front of you did. So there's a good trade-off between having to deal with what's happened right before you're going and what's like blocked and taken versus what your like long-term goal is. So that's a really neat thing about this game too.
It'd be a good cover band name, largely conditional.
Rob, what about you?
Everything they said, I'm in agreement with. To just talk about some other stuff, the art, I really enjoy this. The artist, all the games. Yeah, the Miko. The graphic design is really nice. The iconography is really easy to understand. The pieces are nice. I think this is just the base game. I don't think there's anything extra in it, and it comes with metal coins, which is a plus for me. To expand on the, you know, take a guy, or wait, leave a guy, take a guy.
Take a penny, leave a penny.
Yeah, that mechanism.
Sometimes you end up with a house.
I really like how you start off with, I think they have names, but there's the black, the gray, and the white workers. And you start off with the black pawns, and they can do some stuff worse or better than the other ones. And then eventually you've kind of sent those guys out to raid, and you have the higher ones, and then they do some of that stuff worse, but some of it better. Also, trying to work up on those couple of tracks so you can fight better. Going up on the Valkyrie track is actually pretty lucrative, but it costs you raiding cards, so it takes you longer to like juice back up to keep on
going.
You kind
of got to be your L if you're going to do a lot of Valkyries.
Yeah, which I tried doing, and the game's a lot tighter than I originally thought. It was a lot. The end game was shorter. I had never played this with four before. I really think that it shines maybe like at two or three, because I feel like you get to do more stuff. Like it's not like in the two-player game, there's less to do. There's the exact same amount of stuff to do. So if you feel like you get to do more stuff. I had planned too far ahead, and I ended up with like way too many provisions. And at the end, I probably needed one or two more turns to do something to potentially win. And I'm sure I wasted those somewhere, like trying to gear up, thinking I had more time than I did, which I enjoy the tactics in the game because I'm more of a tactical player than a long-term strategy person. And this game is full of those, and just really got to pay attention. And I don't mind when the game ends at different times. I actually kind of like the fact that you got to pay attention to that. It just kind of bit me in the butt here. So I'd say that's a prawn if we want to kick it in.
Well, yeah, I mean, I've never gone on the record saying it's a bad thing. I just generally tend to appreciate when I know how long a game's going to be for reasons like that. But it's a savvy part of gaming. It's a skill to anticipate the end of a game and maybe set it in motion so that you can win while you're ahead. I think it's an element of the game more than a prawn.
So my other thing I enjoy is you can do multiple things with the raiding party. So the cards you get in your hand, you can either play them to your raiding party or you can play them, which I never did. I was trying not to use the blue part of my cards just to see how that worked. And I kind of wish I would have used kind of the blue power on some of them. So I like how they kind of have a dual purpose where you can either keep them and raid with them And then they have special abilities while they're in your raiding party, or you can decide, no, I want to use this guy for his blue power, and then you go to the other spot and you discard him for that one-time ability.
So a little bit of a prawn for that is that whenever I was looking at my hand, I was just going through and looking at what is the raiding party ability of all these guys, and then what is the blue ability on all these guys. So there would be some times where I'd be like, oh, I think I've got a raiding party ability. Where did it go? And I had spent that card for the blue thing that I wanted, but I just wasn't keeping those matched up to know that if I played that guy, I lost out on something else I was thinking of. So I was like, just I had mental inventory of which ones I had. I wasn't eliminating both the guy off both lists, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, no, I hear you. And then lastly, I think the fact that this game is so easy to get to the table, it has a nice playtime, and the rules are very straightforward. Like, I printed out just kind of a cheater sheet guide, and it was literally like a half a page. I mean, you don't do much on your turn, and the icons kind of speak for themselves. So this is a game that could sit on your shelf for a while, and I'm sure you could pull it out and just kind of know what you're doing right off the bat. You don't got to really dig through the rules.
Well, you could teach, like, I would say, newer non-gamers in just a few minutes, and you could almost sit down and just start playing with people who understand the iconography of games, because the rules are very straightforward.
Yep.
Would you say, from the artwork on these cards versus playing Architects a couple weeks ago, this guy doing the art is doing a even more bang-up job with the art on every new set of cards he does, too?
Mm-hmm.
This one's great, but like Architects had a really cool art.
I think I like
Architects art was a little bit more like
Nickelodeon. Like, there were a lot of like kind of red noses. Sort
yeah,
of,
yeah, there's a word that I can't think of course. But
it was like a little more cartoony.
Yeah.
I like these better, especially the giant beards.
Did you say that the artwork is getting better with every set that he puts out?
Yeah, I think so.
Because the game that we just referenced that everything looks more cartoony came out after this game came out.
No, I like that. I think it's also, it looks really good.
Art is subjective.
Not when I say cartoony, I don't mean like
What if he made
corny.
This? What if he made this art first?
I mean, it looks like an animation.
You just don't know.
Yeah.
Whimsical is the word I was trying to think.
I agree with everything that was said in the pros. Let's move on to prawns. If anybody's got any prawns,
I said mine already.
I do have one because I do think this game would probably play better at two, but I think that the use of a lot of the Raider cards' raiding party abilities are better utilized in a four-player game where points are more dear. Because there's a lot of one where it's like, get one extra point when you do this or one extra point when you do that. I think the four-player games probably end a lot closer because you don't get as many points. So putting those cards in your party would be better utilized in a four-player game, which is kind of tough when this is maybe a game that would be more fun at two or three.
Sure. Cons? Who's got some? Who wants to kick us off?
I don't have any, to be honest.
Oh, perfect. This is my time to shine.
Do it.
Here
we
go.
He's ripping open his shirt. He's got the big C on his chest.
It's probably, I will say that it was probably just from this experience, but there is way too much to chance in this game for the kind of game that this is for me to appreciate. And I will give you a perfect example because it's something that I was working against pretty much until the very end of the game.
Going last?
No, that has nothing to do with it. The fact that the barbarians or the horde or whatever that you're pulling are random instead of on like a sliding scale is infuriating, because when you're going to, especially later game, when you are going to attack the more high value targets to get you points and all of that kind of stuff, not only do you have to have more guys down in your raiding party, but you also generally want to have a high cost, like a high attack value guy. Mm-hmm. And the entire game, with the exception of one card that I was able to continue to cycle back into my hand, no matter how many times I went to the town center or whatever it was, I was pulling zeros and ones, which did me nothing, literally nothing all game. And it got to the point where I just sacked them all with the Valkyries so I could at least get some points. But the fact that I could go and take an action and get two guys that had a combined attack value of zero halfway through the game when attack value is critical, and somebody else could go and get two random cards that give them an attack value of seven by taking the exact same action is broken to me. And in my case, it put a very bad taste in my mouth for this game. There's really no way to, like, you can cycle cards out of your hand by taking the ability, but if it's the end of the game and the ability is to get a provision and you already have a provision, because if you can't raid, you're really only taking the in-town actions. And if you, when you take an in-town action to try and increase your raiding party, if you're not getting better guys for your raiding party, you're stuck in a very broken loop. And it was awful. It was absolutely awful. And I acknowledge that this is my first play of this game, and in a second play, I would probably have a much different experience. But viewing it off of my first time, I would never want to play this game again, like ever.
I don't necessarily disagree that the card draw can be frustrating. From a different standpoint, because I finished in first on this one, so it's not really my right to say that like I didn't get what I was looking for. But I had three decent like barbarian cards. I had two threes and a four. Everything else I got for the entire game was a one or a zero.
That's cool. I got 1-3 all game.
Yeah, yeah.
So your three, a four, your two threes and a four was triple the attack value that I was able to get literally all game.
Yeah, so I'm agreeing with you here, because what I'm saying is once I sent those guys away to the Valkyrie, I was like, well, I'm not going to be doing any more raiding this game, and so I have to try to end it as quick as possible. So it might be nice if there were like a couple different decks.
I don't even think that. I just like, again, I'm not a game designer. I'll never pretend to be, and I know that the decision, like the game works well probably most of the time. My whole thing though is like every like paladins, there's the sliding thing on the apprentices, so you can see what's there and you can pick one, or not paladins, architects has the scale, so you can see what apprentices are available to you, and if one isn't taken, it's cycled through. But the fact that so much of this game lives and dies off of the attack value, and I have to take it at a random chance and through no fault of my own potentially lose the game just because somebody else got lucky on a card draw. With a, like I said, with a game like this, and it, granted it does play quickly, but with a more thinky game, knowing that there is that much of a chance puts a very poor taste in my mouth for this game.
But like in Architects, there's a lot on the value of the green buildings.
But there's so many other ways to easily get points that don't require building green buildings. If you go up the Citadel track, which requires that you actually discard those cards, that's a guaranteed 20 points at the end of the game.
Amy's playing Crimea River back there by Justin Timberlake for you.
That's fine.
I am going to be the devil's advocate here, because I do agree that the card draw can be really frustrating. With that said, you actually, out of all four of us, were the only guy to attack the highest level towers, which can give a lot of points.
But you
didn't get max points from there.
I couldn't come anywhere close to it. It was the only time that I could actually attack, because I had five raiders out, mm-hmm. and my raiding party strength was six or something like that.
I mean, yeah, mine got up any higher than that either.
No, like, I think the reason Campbell did so well is because his raiding party of 3, 3, and 4, especially on those middle territories with like the monastery and some of those others, regardless of what he rolled on the dice, except for I think the first one, he was getting the max amount of victory points that were available to it. I never even had that opportunity. And again, I know I'm crying and I know I'm upset. The spread wasn't that awful, all things considered. It was just so frustrating to all game just be I felt like there was a handicap for a first time player, sure. Which was very frustrating.
My guess is though that the powers are balanced to the fact that I bet the lower powered guys probably have better / cooler abilities, maybe,
but
I mean, that'd be my guess. I know that doesn't help you in your rating.
Yeah, that's half the game.
And the only thing you can do to mitigate that is to move up that red track so you don't need as strong of a party. But still, to get high points in the other ones, you do need it. I mean, they could just make it like a card row.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
And that would fix it.
I would house rule this with a card row, and I would say at the end of every round, whatever one's at the end, if none's taken, gets discarded, and a new one comes up, so you at least have a choice at which card you draft, and then it slides at the end of the round.
So I am going to be a devil's advocate here now, because you kind of stopped me from making the point I was going to make, but I'll be really quick on it, because we should get on to the next part. So there are a few things. I would actually applaud the idea of a card row for this, because I think that, again, what you say has merit. However, there is, I think, a lot of things you can do with lousy cards. In fact, I think there's three things. One is you can get a lot of goods from raiding those harbors, and you don't have to have any specific guys. If you have lousy cards in your hand, you can get more guys out more quickly, because the big power ones cost more money to get out, right? So you can go very early and get a lot of those harbors. A lot of the lower cards give you extra points when you crash harbors. A lot of those Valkyries, you can have kill off like early dudes to get a lot of points there. You'll come back with a lot of resources. You can double the value of the resources by going to the place where you like double up your resources. And then you can utilize, you know, when you go back and work, like the card draw ability.
Sure.
I did hit three of those monasteries, which is the penultimate, you know, fortress, but the most points you can get are lower than the fewest points you can get from the fortresses. The reason I ended up winning the game is because I hit two harbors and three monasteries very quickly in the game, and then just whittled my supplies for the rest of the game trying to end it quickly, because I was in the same point where like I didn't really have that strong of a force to go up to the towers.
Yeah, and that's like I said, I think you what was the final point spread?
It was not big. Yeah, it was like, exactly. It was like 8 points.
And so like I said, it's not the end of the world. Yeah. Like I was, but I knew after like the first four rounds that there was no way I was going to be able to win. And so, I mean, it is what it is, like I said. And I will also say, I think the thing that you just laid out with a lot of the, like, one of the pros that I will give this game is I did like at the beginning that all of the resources that come out and get put onto the different spaces that you're raiding are random each game, because we had some spaces that didn't have Valkyries. We had some that were loaded on them. But I'll say your thing of, you know, going and fight, like, all of that stuff is situational, as is my experience that I had.
Yeah.
I'm sure this is a good game. It's one of those, like, it puts such a bad taste in your mouth the first time that you're hesitant to play it again when there are thousands of other games that I still have to go try for the first time, you know? It's like if I have a bad experience, cool, I had a bad experience, I didn't like it, that's okay. There are other games of this designer that I would rather go play, so I'm just going to play those games.
I don't know how, like, I don't know how you would do a card row in this game, though, because you don't pay for the cards.
Yeah, you just flip five and choose two, and then you just keep loading it up. It just gives people more to choose from.
Or draw four, pick two.
Mm-hmm.
Just something.
That'd probably be a good way to do it.
It killed me, and I know I'm pissed.
You'd move through the deck a lot faster.
Yeah, I know. And the other part is the other part that I thought was a little frustrating is because I did go to a couple harbors early on, and I got a couple resources. But then when I know there's a sage or some card, but I would love to see an ability that also allows you to cycle the contracts that you're fulfilling. And I know that makes it tough because those are things that people are working against. But if you go to a bunch of harbor spots to get a bunch of goods and then none of those goods come up in the contract row, then it's just like,
there was
cool. What?
There was a card.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Okay. I said, I know you have a card, like, but I'd like to see that I'd like to see that.
Like a water Davian type.
Yeah.
Thing.
Not just as like a, you get this one card in the deck and that lets you do the thing,
well,
but it's like
water deep in action.
Yeah. If there's nothing available, then you just, you know, you can do it again.
Cycle those boys.
Just gripes of a guy who's pissed that he got by the game. But anybody else have any other cons?
My main con for this game is just like, to me, for a gateway Euro, there's stuff I think I would teach people new to games first, and for like something, you know, to stand the test of time, there's just games I find way more compelling. So my subjective thing, which I usually don't really get into, is I can't see this game getting to the table for either reason for me very much, which I rarely say. I think it's fantastic for what it is, and I think there's definitely a home for it. It just doesn't really trip my trigger. Maybe the hats aren't flat. Like, they wear spiky hats, which is like the opposite. The opposite of spiky floppy hats.
Well, and I mean, honestly, I think one of the cons for this game, it's a pron maybe. I don't know where to really put it, but this game, and it's the same. The artwork, the title, the name, everything is so similar to Architects, and I think Architects is subjectively and based off of the BGG ranking, objectively a better game. And so it's like, why would
yep,
I
won.
But still it's like, if every gripe that I just spent 10 minutes flaming on is fixed in Architects of the West Kingdom because they have the apprentice draw row and all of those kinds of things, why would I play this game if I feel that there's a game that takes this and does everything better? I don't have any of the expansions for it. I don't have any of the upgrades. There's no,
it's a different game.
Is it though? I mean, it's an introduction to worker placement still.
It is.
Yeah, it's a different game.
Yeah, but
if
that's,
this had different art, you wouldn't be thinking.
In architects, you're building
similar.
Something, and here you're rating stuff. Yeah, I mean, just because something's a worker placement game and another thing is a worker placement game doesn't make them that similar. I mean, I'm not gonna like get into a big philosophical debate about this, but I don't have many cons for this. I'm not like a champion of this game by any means.
Is this the hill you're gonna die on, Rob?
No, 100% not. Like, to be honest, like when this originally came out, and like. It's like, oh, cool. They're just making lots of Viking worker placement games. Oh, there's more. And there's three in this trilogy. Then there's like five of these. And ultimately, like none of them are, I mean, they're all fine, right? Like none of them I'm that super stoked about. Out of all of them, though, I want to move into final thoughts because my final thought on this game is I like this better than Architects. If I were to play any of them, it'd probably be this one.
More than Paladins?
I think just because like this game is simple. I think you could pull this out with anybody and just to kind of play it. And it's simple. It's quick. I really like the pick one up or play one and pick one up mechanism. Yeah, out of all the games, like this is the one that I like the best.
Isn't it crazy how
and
many...
And I don't... If I like it the best, like if I really liked it, it'd be on my shelf in there and it's not. So that's where it
something.
Is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Isn't it crazy how many games really like kind of Viking themed worker placement games came out in like the span of 2 years? Because there was this and Champions of Midgard and that Viking like mountain one we played with Jason a few times.
Like the 7878 Vikings or whatever it was called.
What was that one called?
No.
It actually had a really neat...
Like it was like a, had like a spinning wheel or something, didn't it?
Yeah, it had like a spinning mountain that you could change and like you went down and those were your actions.
Yeah.
And then there was Vikings.
Blood Rage.
Vikings is the new zombies.
Yeah, man. I guess.
I'm the new zombie.
Campbell, what are your final thoughts?
You can't kill me.
What's a Viking zombie called?
I should know this.
Gart Wolfslinger.
Draugr. Yeah.
Yeah, those guys are so easy to sneak up on in Skyrim.
That's true. 100% true.
Skyrim is so fun. I'm still playing it 8 years later. Great game. Fun game.
What are your final thoughts on this game?
I kind of want to go play Skyrim. My final thoughts on Raiders of the North Sea are I think this is a well-made game with all of its flaws that I do agree with Josh saying, mitigatable by the fact that turns are quick and the game is short. I think this is a great jumping off point for getting into board games. And the only negative thing I said about it, like, I was probably a little harsh. I tend to try to get people into... I really like Ticket to Ride. I know people knock on that. They clown on Ticket to Ride, but I think that's a really good introductory game. But this could be in my collection for the purpose of like game nights where people haven't played a lot of games. I don't know if it ever hit my table with
the
like
other
a group
option.
Like this, right? Yeah. Yeah.
Ben?
So my final thoughts are that I definitely did like Architects. I enjoyed the art, and so this is sort of more of the same. Obviously Josh feels it is much of the same mechanics. The art is, it's the same artist. It is shorter, so that is, it's kind of like you can get the feel visually you get from Architects but with a shorter gameplay and sort of a different theme. Like Rob was kind of saying, they are seeming to make a whole bunch of these that are similar art and worker placement. So I don't think I'd own them all. I think I'd want to play them all and then get like the two that I liked the best or the one that I liked the best. Yeah. I enjoyed it.
Final thought.
You still hate it.
It's how do I,
oh, he's yes. coming around, ladies and gentlemen.
I hated my experience of this game. Now, as I said, everything in this
but
game.
But you're also a Vikings fan.
I am also a Vikings fan. Yeah, that's. But if it's like one of those, like, if I were to play this game right now, if it were to get done, I'm sure I would have a completely different experience because
if you
the
had
cards that I would
smoked
pull
Cam,
would be a little
you
different.
You would have been.
Yeah, exactly.
You would love this
exactly.
game.
Exactly. But that
you know
didn't.
How many games that I have
that,
lost miserably
but that
in
didn't
this
happen.
Basement
but that
and
didn't
still
happen.
Enjoyed?
But that Black
and
Angel?
Didn't rip on?
Black Angel?
I don't think I rip on that. I'm just saying that was too complex for me. Like, that was the jumping off point. And I will play Food Chain Magnate happily.
If I went to a game night and somebody said, hey, we're playing Raiders, I would gladly play it.
You would leave immediately.
No, I would gladly
play it.
You
would pout in the corner.
If I had my say on anything, I would not pick this. I would rather play Architects of the Western Kingdom. And from a couple plays that I had of it, I would also rather play Paladins of the Western Kingdom.
Would you rather play this or Grand Austria Hotel?
I don't know. I've never played Grand Austria Hotel. Give me another.
You would probably play this.
You would play this.
You would hate Grand Austria Hotel.
Okay.
My review of Grand Austria Hotel was, Josh would have hated this.
That's true. I remember editing that. But before we wrap up, let's see what our friends at Meeple Overboard think.
Hey, before we have Chris talk.
It's not Chris.
Oh, Wendy's going to talk.
It's Wendy.
Wendy's talking about this.
Before we don't have Chris talk.
So, Chris gave me a call like I asked him to on that last episode the other day, and we talked for a few minutes. I actually talked to Wendy for a little bit too. Hey guys, thanks so much for calling me. I need to call you guys soon. Chris, take your turn in Terraforming Mars, the app. By the way, I'm your _pal_cam at Terraforming Mars. Shoot me a message. Let's play. I wanted to since Meeple Overboard is coming onto our podcast to talk, I thought I'd listen to their most recent episode of the podcast and make a comment on that. Hey, you guys, I loved when you were talking about Squirrels in My Pants on, I think, Phineas and Ferb. Josh can fact check me on this.
No, it was. I love that show. It's so good.
I watched that song you guys are talking about. I've never seen it. What I will say is those freestyle rapping kids who sang that song about squirrels in my pants, why are they singing most of the song and not rapping most of the song? Because they look like they're supposed to be rappers. Either way, great song. Great thing to have in your pants.
Great show. 10 out of 10. Would recommend.
Love you guys a lot. I can't wait to hear what Wendy has to say about Raiders of the North Sea.
Well, let's find out.
Hi, everyone. I'm Wendy from Meeple Overboard. Now, I adore worker placement games, so adding a unique mechanism of placing and then picking up workers has absolutely fascinated me. It creates a new way of strategizing turns because you can't completely block spaces, so choosing what will be available for others to pick up is the new puzzle. I'm actually amazed with how successful this has been, that this mechanism hasn't been used in any other games. It must be more difficult to implement than it seems. I also tend to enjoy multi-use cards, so the persistent effects versus the one-time abilities add some good decision-making because, of course, I want both abilities. Now, thematically, this game is also fun because I get to lead war-hungry Vikings, raiding and pillaging and eating bags of food. Finally, I'd say the one drawback for me is the sameness of the game. Strategies are either raiding fortresses or raiding weaker spots to give offerings. There's little variation between the two. I've played the Hall of Heroes expansion, which adds some fun new uses for cards and set collection. I played the game a lot before playing the expansion and felt a little burnt out. Hall of Heroes didn't add enough for me to overcome that. But overall, fun game that very much shines for me because of the uniqueness of its mechanisms. I'm Wendy from Meeple Overboard, and I'd love to have you welcome my special guest, the Board Boys.
Well, you do know that we're on their show right now, right?
Raiding and pillaging their podcast.
Oh, that's fine. Yeah, just make sure to get me a bag of food.
This is Gart's podcast.
Wendy, Chris, thank you so much as always for your thoughts. I got to say, I disagree with you on some of them. I am intrigued by the Hall of Heroes expansion and the additional set collection. Maybe that would fix some of the issues I had
with
the game.
Josh perked right up because he knew he would have had the set collection of all the zero value workers.
All the zero value workers belong to me. And yeah, who doesn't love a good bag of food?
I like to say good bit at the end there. That made me chuckle.
Yeah. Rob, anything that you'd like to tell Chris and Wendy?
No, just, she said everything I said.
That's
so
true. Well, we hope you guys enjoyed.
We can edit it that way.
We hope you guys enjoyed our latest episode of Meeple Board Boys podcast, the only bonus episode of Meeple Overboard inside an episode of the Board Boys podcast.
Can I do a theme song for the show? And it'll be at the end of this time for this time while we do this.
Sure.
So,
in addition to their background music that they had the whole time, there was some high quality
production
material there.
Hey. That was Meeple Overboard Boys podcast, huh?
Nope. Swing and a miss. But
next time.
You got a week to figure it out.
You're not getting closer, but you're also not getting further away. You're just sort of circling.
I've had to do so many theme songs for this thing, and it's with no accompaniment.
You know what we should do? We should come up with a
Can
contest.
Can I just get a MIDI keyboard?
We come up with, Cam, you need to come up with some options, and then we'll have a Twitter poll. We'll label them, and then we'll see, what people like.
Yeah. I do have
want accompaniment? Let's get a MIDI keyboard in here. I'll play a random chord, and then that'll be your, like, you know how a quartet goes like.
Yeah.
And well, then no, they
I have
sing?
An awesome little Korg keyboard with like a little arpeggiator and stuff. I'll bring that in next time, and I'll do a little song. It'll be great.
Okay.
You know, I feel like it's appropriate to bring back one of the most beloved segments of the Board Boys podcast this episode, because we got some help on the theme song tonight. So with that, we're going to jump into one of my personal favorite segments, Beef or Plug.
Beef or Plug!
There's a fork in the road and I don't know which way to go, plug or beef.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our segment called Beef or Plug. Now, we haven't done this in a while, but Bo, Rob's son, he loves singing the theme song, and it was too adorable to say no, and I hope he listens to this, and he knows that he's famous because he was on the podcast that his dad does. But essentially what we're going to do is we're going to throw something out. It could be a random place, a person, a thing. It doesn't really matter, and then everyone else is going to guess if we're about to give them some praise or if we're about to throw some shade at them.
Josh, if your thing is Raiders of the North Sea, I'm going to guess beef.
I'm going to kick us off. This is an easy one. I'm going to say fantasy football.
Beef.
That's a hard beef.
Sounds like a plug to me.
That is a hard beef.
Ah!
Fantasy football is the bane of my existence every year. And let me tell you why. It drives me insane that at the end of the season, I can be fourth.
He's only had.
I can be.
Cards are worth zero and 1 point.
I can be fourth overall in points scored, second overall in points against, and still finish ninth in the league.
Josh.
It drives me crazy.
Josh.
Out of a 12-man league.
Josh, you are playing a game based off of stats of other people playing a game.
Yes.
With a lot of variables.
I understand. I know how football works.
I think we're getting somewhere here. You can't handle losing.
No, I can. I totally can.
No, you can't.
When I lost to you twice this season, I don't believe I flamed. I think I said, man, James Conner really let me down. And I left it at that. And then you didn't text me back for 3 days because you were like, oh.
You didn't text me back for three days.
You are getting my text messages. And then
I texted you for a week
like
and you didn't reply
to
like any
payback.
Of them.
That's what I should have said. I should have said beef or plug. Ben's text messaging abilities.
Here you go, guys. Beef or plug. Josh's phone usage.
I'm going to go with
plug.
Beef.
That's a plug.
That's
big
a hard
plug.
That's also a hard beef. But that wasn't a real thing.
No. Campbell, what are you thinking? Who are you beefing or plugging this evening?
A Goofy movie.
Great. It's a plug. 100%. 1,000%. 1,000,000%. It's a plug.
Yeah, plug for sure.
Plug, I guess.
Okay, I gotta say.
Wait, beef, because you don't think just the Goofy movie is worth $6.99 a month.
No, he's gonna do something stupid where he's gonna be like, I think it's a beef because I really wish the movie was like 10 minutes longer.
No. This is a legitimate beef.
It's value.
I haven't seen the movie in a while, based beef. And I will say, I think pretty highly of the Goofy movie. There's a lot of really, like the plot of the movie is, but there's a lot of like good songs. There's some poignant moments where like you actually kind of feel what it's like, you know, where you actually feel, you know, like kind of remember like what it's like having a relationship with your parents growing up. And I'm not a parent yet, but maybe for those of you who are parents, like kind of like that feeling of a parent of like, oh, my kids are getting older. You know, how they grow up so fast. Really, really nice movie. The plot of the movie, though, is so unbelievable.
Are you kidding? Your beef is that a Disney movie
for eight-year-olds
with Goofy as the main character is unbelievable?
Here's the problem. Disney Plus came out, and so everyone's rushed to rewatch movies that they have fond memories of as a child. But how many years has it been since you've watched this movie?
20?
25?
It holds up.
The movie holds up, but why?
But it doesn't match your memory of the movie.
Why can't
and you watch it as late 20s, early 30s? And
yeah, that's
go,
right. I'm in my late 20s.
Yeah, whatever. And you go,
not halfway through my 30s.
Well, that's not what it was.
No, but like, why can't this high school kid just explain to his dad that he got a date with the hottest girl in school and that he's not in a gang and they can go on the trip in a week?
Because his dad thinks that he's getting kicked out of school, so
yeah,
he takes him on a trip.
So he can't take 30 seconds to be like, Dad, why do you think that I'm going to
be in a, like, why do you think I'm in a gang? And be like, because your principal said so. He'd be like, oh, my principal's insane. He'd be like, oh, yeah.
I'd be like, oh, yeah. He'd be like, oh, yeah, your principal's insane because you just launched him through a trap door and then dressed up as a performer.
Hold on.
Vandalized the school with a fire extinguisher.
With Pauly Shore.
Almost killed yourself because you went parading through the rafters on a rope and a hook system. But yeah,
why is there a rope and a hook system in a school?
Where falling through a trap door doesn't hurt anybody.
Oh, sure, sure.
You do understand that like miscommunication is the leading cause of like plot.
Every single movie.
Right, like if there wasn't miscommunication or something like, you could have solved this if you would have just talked to each other before you started, but no. We need to play a whole movie around this.
The best kids movie plot is in Beethoven when they kidnap Beethoven so they can shoot him with an exploding bullet. That's the plot of Beethoven. Also, the plot of the Aristocats is the butler tries to kill these cats because the lady puts the cats in the will.
And then at the end, he gets shipped to Timbuktu, and the woman's like, man, if only he knew he was in my will, I bet he'd still be here.
Can we start another podcast as just like one-line plot synopsis?
No, but I did have a really good idea. I had an idea for a podcast to capitalize on the hype of Disney Plus right now, where every week you literally just work your way through the whole catalog, and every week you just do a full-on review of the episode of like the movie that you watched, including original shows, original content, everything. It may exist.
I thought it was just creating one about Baby Yoda drinking White Claw.
Yeah, yeah. Rob, what are you beefing or plugging tonight?
Roundabouts.
That's a beef. You got a stupid roundabout right in front of your house, and it's the worst. It's worse than this game.
It's worse than this game.
Yeah.
It's you hate it for the same reason you hate this game, is that you can't figure out how to use it properly. Boom.
Campbell, what do you think, man? Is this a beef or a plug? Roundabouts.
Roundabouts sounds like a full-on beef.
It's a beef.
It's a plug. He's plugging the roadwork capital improvements going on in his neighborhood.
It is a big time beef.
Nailed it.
Because people don't know how to drive around them.
Nailed it.
The one in front of our house, actually, they had to put like signs in it because people were just driving, like high school kids were just driving straight up and through and over it. and today, if I didn't slow down for somebody who, you know, apparently if you're in the roundabout, you're supposed to be the one who yields. That's not how those work. I would have totally ran into somebody today as I was going around the roundabout. They even looked at me. I had Bo in the back. I like wanted to run the car down and like yell at him.
Yeah. Ben, take us home. Who are you beefing or plugging?
The beef or the plug tonight is my car's rear left tire.
That is a beef.
I want to live in a world where this could be a plug, but I can't think of any reason for it to be one, so I will also go beef.
I'm an optimist. I'll say plug.
Cam is the only right one. It is a plug because it is leaking, and I do need to plug it.
Oh.
Ba-da-tsh. He'll be here
but
all
until
week,
then, I'll just go to the gas station every 3 to 4 days and fill it up.
I thought you were going to be like, it's a plug because it's the only one of my tires that didn't explode when I rolled over those.
When I drove up through that roundabout, that was the only tire that didn't explode.
You know, I really like the tire gauges at the Hy-Vee gas stations because they you can set it to like the tire pressure you want on there, and then it just shuts off when you get there.
Oh, nice. That's really cool. Well, hey,
I never worry about like what's actually in there because it's always going to leak down. No. So as long as it's not like squished out on the sides. This is coming from someone who has the tools to fix it himself, but just hasn't.
I think that brings us to the end, gentlemen. Season 5, episode 5, this is Raiders of the North Sea.
I can't drive 55.
I just tied with Rob for first place for the season on this this episode. Haha.
Cool.
Who's keeping track of that?
Only at the beginning of the season. I have no idea how we did
time,
at the end of season 4.
You can check us out on Twitter at The Board Boys Pod. We're on Facebook, Instagram, and Gmail at The Board Boys Podcast. Come hang with us at a couple cons coming up. Campbell and I are going to be at ATBCon 2020 in Nebraska City, Nebraska in mid-January. You can find out all the details there on Board Game Geek. We're also going to be at GameCon in Cedar Rapids, Iowa, which is coming up February 27th, 28th, and 29th. It's on the leap year this year. And you can find out more details there on their tabletop events site.
Leapicon.
Until next time.
This is Josh Ladd boning out.
Gart hopes you like board games.